at 6 during the Sabbath. Proverbs chapter 26 and verse 6. He who sends a message by the hand of a fool cuts off his own feet and drinks violence.
And I know we went over it. I just wanted to start one above. We went over there.
Verse 7. Like the legs of the lame that hangs limp is a proverb in the mouth of fools.
Amen.
Verse
8.
Like one who binds a stone in a sling is he who gives honor to a fool.
And we understand that, right? We understand that. Read it again.
Like the legs of the lame.
No, the one after that. The stone.
Like one who binds a stone in a sling is he who gives honor to a fool.
It's not going to be effective. Amen? We know that, right? It's not to give honor to a fool. It's not going to be effective. No more than binding a stone in a sling. It's not going to be effective. We understand that, right? Because if you're a fool, he's foolish. It's not going to be effective. Go ahead.
Verse 9. Like a thorn that goes into the hands of a drunkard is a proverb in the mouth of fools.
And how many of y'all noticed? I know, like we talked about it last week, but I just want to kind of say that if you studied and you read 26, he deals a lot with the fools. You know what I'm saying? And you know, the Bible says, when we talk about, I think one of the greatest scriptures in Carolina was saying, there's a fool that says there is no God. And when we read these things, why is it, the way the Bible is projecting a fool is someone that's not really God conscious to the wisdom or to the word of God. Not only God conscious to the wisdom or to the word, but in utilizing the word of God. You know what I'm saying? Someone who is not going to utilize the word of God and not conscious to the word of God is somewhat foolish. Everybody understand that? Because I'm not going to ponder a lot on, but he's doing a lot of giving us the understanding of a fool. And there's a reason for that, because sometimes, you know, we can think we wise and be very foolish. You know what I'm saying? And how many of you know, if you perceive to be wise in your own eyes, but you are in conflict with the word of God, you are foolish. You know, that's what the scripture says, the way unto man that seemeth right, but leads to destruction. Well, though it may seem right in your eyes, you're foolish, because he who knows, he who is truth, says it's not. And really today, the reason I'm telling why this is important today, because really today there's a lot of things that are said that appear to be truth by men and appear to be wisdom, but they are in total conflict of the word of God. You know what I'm saying? They're total in conflict to the word of God. You know, it's interesting, because in the New Testament, you know, in the Old Testament it says an eye for an eye, right? We know that, right? But we do know that that's not what it says in the New Testament. We know that, right? So the New Testament would tell us, don't do evil for evil. So just out of curiosity, so would the death sentence be something that we should apply or not apply? Everybody quiet. I'm just throwing a question out there. In the New Testament, should we apply the death sentence? Should a nation apply the death sentence? Yeah, nay. Yes? Why?
Because what came to my mind was Romans chapter 13, where it talks about we ought to respect like the men that God placed in order, like police officers and like army men, because God, they're actually servants for God. If you do good or if you do evil, that's what came to my mind.
No, I agree with you that a law enforcement, that somebody should, that someone should be punished. I didn't say someone, should they not be punished. I just asked, should we give the death sentence? there's a difference between punishing someone than giving them the death sentence. I just thought I'd throw that question off. Something I read today to make me want to think about throwing that question out there, especially when you hear what we just read. Anybody else? What do you think? Go ahead. What do you think?
I would say no, because if that's the case, then all of us deserve to die right now.
Okay, that's a good point. That's a good point. Go ahead. It's interesting because I want us to kind of think about that for a minute. Go ahead.
Okay, so it's more of a question, I guess, because I guess the way that would play out in my mind would depend on what stance you're standing from. If you're operating, obviously, under God with the Spirit leading you, then no, you would not repay evil for evil. However, for those that are operating in the world system, if they were to go about, you know, punishment or even, I guess, what is it that you were saying, the death penalty, the fact that it also is saying to honor the authority, then it kind of sounds like you would have to, you know, that's where it's a little bit confusing, because if I'm honoring authority, even though I would disagree with what they're doing, I would have to respect the fact that that they're in place for that. And even how it was talking about with, I forget which book it is, but he was talking about to the slaves, how if your master, you know, is to... Do you know where I'm going?
Yeah,
the part? But I'm saying, because from us on a believer standpoint, obviously in the eyes of God, it would not be right. But then the fact that they're placing authority, if the, you know, it's like, how would you weigh that to argue that?
Okay, let it go. Valerie did Barbara.
I would say, like how the young man was saying, with grace, that's why the death penalty wouldn't apply, because like he was saying, if grace wasn't applied through Christ coming with the new covenant, we all would die. We would all would be, our judgment would be death, because before grace came, death came. Like, God didn't give, like, King Saul and some of them grace, because they knew better, because they was in the presence of God daily. But when Christ came, he gave us grace, but we're not supposed to use that grace to misinterpret what the truth is giving us to transform ourselves.
Right beside you.
So when you say death sentence, you mean incarcerating someone until they die? And
no, I mean like executing them.
Oh, execution.
Yeah.
Okay, then. I thought you meant death sentence. Execution?
No, I mean execution.
Okay, got it. Okay, then. My point is, my statement is not valid to execution.
I think somebody can stay in jail for...
Yeah. For I thought you were talking about for a death sentence, it's execution.
No, Karina. And I'm gonna make a statement after she says, I want to throw this out there for a minute. Go ahead.
I say no, because to basically say somebody is due death for what they did is to become a judge. So that's judgment. And the Word of God, according to the New Testament, tells us not to judge. You know what I mean? Lest we be basically measured by that same measure. And if we measure ourselves by that same measure, we all, like they said, deserve death. So I say no, because it means that you have become a judge, meaning that you are the one who says that somebody deserves life or death. And we don't have that type of authority.
Go ahead, Stacey. And we're going to bring it home.
Okay. I would say no, because we're followers of Christ. And the example I'm going to use, when the woman was caught in adultery, her sentence was death. And because Christ was there and we were walking in his steps, he wrote down, and when he looked at all her accusers, and he said, those without sin cast the first stone, and they drop all the stone and walk away. And he said to the lady, you know, you go and you sin no more. So my answer would be no.
Okay, I understood. I want to kind of tie it up. And the reason I asked that, I wanted, because as a son and a daughter, do you have an option to be in compliance with that or not? And what's interesting is, when I look at the scriptures, I don't see. I know, like what Jazzy says. Okay, we live in a country that says, okay, that's an option, that they can choose to be a death sentence, to give the death sentence. Am I in agreement with that or not in agreement with that? See, as a son, I don't have to be in agreement with what this country says. Just because this country says, I don't have to be in agreement with it. Actually, if somebody was to murder somebody in my family, it was a death sentence, I can object to that also. I can object to that line of punishment. And they may do it anyway, but because the state has the final, but I guess the question was, because I think sometimes there are statements and situations that are made, and as sons and daughters, should we go in compliance with society or remain standing up on the word of God? And like the gentleman said, because the, you know, it wasn't eye for an eye, but in, and I think people think, you know, well, I feel this way. And I guess why I said it, because it's a lot of people, especially today as sons and daughters, I mean, as Christians, be like, man, well, this is how I feel. I even heard somebody say on a radio station, they were talking about abortion. Well, I feel like, no, I'm not for abortion unless in certain cases. And they were saying that as a Christian. And I wonder about things like that, because I'm like, so when did our opinions, your opinion begin to have to be in, when does your opinion become in conflict with the word of God? In other words, if God says something, can you be a Christian and be in moving and totally contrary to that which God is saying? Anybody kind of get what anybody understand the question I'm asking? You know what I'm saying? It's not for me. If 99% of society says, I'm going along with this, and God says, it doesn't line up with God's word, then I'm not going along with that. I'm not going, I have, and it's not because I might not, it's some, I don't even be like, well, I don't know, but I'm not going along with it because God said, don't go along with it. Because if God is not along with it, neither am I. Regardless of what society and anybody say, if God is not along with it, I'm not going to be in agreement with it. Because watch this, to be in agreement with it would be to be at all with God. And they said this, they told the disciples, don't go back out there and speak, preach in the name of Jesus Christ anymore. And they said, is it better for us to obey man or for us to obey God? And they continue to go on. And some people like to play games. Well, that's not really. No, anything that you do, your life is a reflection of God and the word of God. And your life and my life should not move contrary to that. What that word is, regardless what society says. I don't know what y'all think. Yes.
I think sometimes that it's like a system, like, you know, like, I'm going to go against what God said, you know what I mean? Like, I think, like, people don't, like, people, those days, people don't care what God said.
And I kind of agree with you. I mean, there's not a consciousness on what God says. It's like more of a consciousness on what society might be going along with. But I'm hoping that we get an awakening of a consciousness of God. Go ahead, let that hold again.
I see it this way, based on the question you asked. So it's two views. You got a spiritual worldview and a worldview.
Right.
A biblical worldview and a secular worldview.
Right.
And I put me out there. You know, I grew up in public housing and all that stuff. And we was taught, you know, you need to do it this way. You know, what the world say. And we all, to a degree, have been indoctrinated by the world system. You know what I'm saying? We've been taught by the world how to conduct, how to handle people, how to handle situations. But then, as you saying, God spells it out totally different. So I just feel like one of Satan's master plans is he going to pervert everything the word says. Whatever God said do, he flips it.
Right.
And like you said, we just have to have a consciousness of that.
And that's why I think the Bible says you have to be, your mind cannot be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, proving that which is the perfect will of God. In other words, my mind has to line up with the will of God. And like the young brother said, and it's funny because I think many of us in this room, all of us, I'm not going to say all of us in this room, in some area or some situation, we find ourselves sometimes in battle with when that's why that word, when it penetrates, you find yourself in battle with a thought that you believed for a long time, and then God's word comes in, and you're like, well, and sometimes we have a problem, how we may see women, how we may see men, how we deal with money, that truth comes in, and you find yourself in conflict with that truth. Y'all get what I'm saying? And what's so good about God is God's desire is to, that truth begin, when we yield to that truth, it begins to bear fruit. So we know, begins to bear fruit and begins to bring transformation. Everybody with me? You know what I'm saying? So I think somebody had their hand up for a minute. Heavenly, go ahead. We're going to go one more, then we're going to keep on going. And while he's giving her the mic, let me tell you why I did this. I know it's kind of like the one reason I did this is because when I think about Proverbs, I think about wisdom. And I think about the wisdom of God and God giving wisdom to Solomon and giving wisdom to David to begin to expound on God's perception of things. But what is happening is, like the gentleman said, we've been indoctrinated in a carnal that to God, the way we think is foolishness. That's why I did it. I wanted you to see, because see, sometimes we may say, well, he's talking about foolish, but I don't think foolish. But yeah, sometimes we do think foolish. When you're thinking contrary to God's way of doing things, that's a foolish way of thinking. And it may appear to be wise to you because, like the gentleman said, you've been indoctrinated in that situation. But I'm going to tell you something. And then people like to think this. There is no absolute truth. That's another lie. There is absolute truth. You know what I'm saying? And people like to think, you know, well, truth is relevant based on one's own perspective. That's a lie. No, truth is not relevant based on your perspective. Truth is what God, the word of God says. And it's not left up. And it's a problem. People like, this is what I think confuse a lot of people because of religion. People think the word of God is left up to interpretation. No, it's not left up to interpretation. The word of God is not left up to interpretation. What it is it's left up to revelation. God gives you a revelation of his, and revelation means an insight of God's view of word. The Bible says Paul had great revelation, not self-interpretation. Everybody understand? So go ahead, Evan.
Well, actually, majority of what I said, you just said. I just wanted to pinpoint when. See, I really understand it based on just the Bible. You know, a lot of times the reason why people are so adamant about agreeing to what the world is doing or agreeing to the things that are contrary to the word of God is because they actually don't really read the Bible. They don't really read the word of God. They don't really digest the truth, what is truly the truth, you know? Right. Like they don't, a lot of times, and I'm, you know, I'm thankful for one body and just here because we're positioned to really read the word, to really meditate on the word. Right. And when you begin to do that, it leaves no room for you to kind of second guess yourself. But when you're at these religious structured churches and places where, I mean, we sometimes, without having the projector, we were already disciplined to know to bring our Bible, to have our word on deck, like right away. But in a lot of churches, they got their Bibles where you can just pick it up right there. Like you're not really unction to have your word with you, you know, to have it as a weapon for you. And that's why a lot of people who they're portraying to be Christian out of a fad, like a form and a fashion, but they're not reading their Bible. So when it comes to standing on the word of God, it's like, well, I don't really have to because, I mean, they don't know what the word says. So that's what I was just going
to
say.
You know what? I want to say this, and we're going to go on. I want to say in the scripture, what's amazing about when you think about the Bible, and the Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God, that we ought to study the word of God to show yourself. But why does he say that? He said, because my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. I don't know. And I'm going to tell you something, why I like a little bit what Heavenly said. I think what goes on today is too, we're in a time where people are mixing too much of self in God. In other words, we're tainting the word with our own ideology, with our own culture, with our own mindset. Well, if I'm black, I'm going to taint that word. I'm going to make the word become black. Or if I'm Spanish, my culture is going to now shape the word of God. And that's why I think it's so powerful when you read John's around the fourth chapter. I believe he said that the true worshiper will worship him in spirit and truth. And that's why Jesus did this too. I love when they came to Jesus. They said, Jesus, your mom and your sisters and your brother, said, my mom, my sisters, my brothers are those who do the will of my Father, taking it from a fleshly connection and bringing it to a spiritual place, letting you know that later on, because I think, you know, Jesus, God knew what he was going to do, that people won't try to bring him down and connect to him, bring him down and make him like us instead of us humbling ourselves, that he may transform us into him. Amen? In that situation. And I wanted to throw that out there through Proverbs, because if you're listening through Proverbs, then he keeps saying fool, fool, fool. And I want to kind of expound on that, because the bottom line is, like Heavenly said, if you're not in the word of God, then you can be foolish and not even know it. You know what I'm saying? The Bible says there's a way unto man to seem right. You can be foolish and not even knowing it. There's a surrendering of you, a renewing of your mind in the word of God. The Bible says, let the same mind be in me which is in Christ Jesus. People say, okay, this is what we do. All right, except for this situation when it comes to money. All right, except for this situation when it comes to women. All right, except for this situation when it comes to family. In other words, we have these exceptions to the rule. You know what I'm saying? In other words, God, I'm going to have your mind, but I got some exceptions to the rule because I know what kind of man I want. Well, God, I'm going to have your mind, but I'm going to have this exception to the rule because I know what kind of business and what I want to establish. Well, a dead person, let me say that again. A dead person, because the first thing Jesus said, do deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. Amen? I just want to throw that. So,
all right, Proverbs 26, verse 10. The great God who formed everything gives the fool his hire and the transgressor his wages.
The great God that does what? He forms all things, give the fool the what? His desire, huh? And what?
He gives the fool his hire and the transgressor his wages.
And sometimes I'm going to tell you something. That means you God going to give you what. But I'm going to tell you something. In that verse, you got to understand something too. Because he didn't give us. He gave the transgressor. He came and paid the price for the transgressor. That's why he had to pay the price. Because the fact is that it had to be paid. You know what I'm saying? He couldn't override it. So he did give the food of the transgressor by dying for us. And in that, he gave us grace. Amen. So we received something we didn't deserve because he took on what we did deserve. So he gave it. So what he did, he gave it to Jesus. Jesus took on what he was given to us that you and I may take on. He took on our sins that we may take on his righteousness. Amen. So I don't want us to be twisted in this verse right here thinking that God didn't just say no. He unpoured his wrath upon Jesus Christ. You and I are free today. Because Jesus Christ took the wrath of our sins. Because to say that God would have ignored it is to say that God would have thought that his laws were not just in the first place. And that's not going to happen. Anything that God says is righteous. So he had to punish. He had to pour the wrath of his law upon. He's not like man. Man will throw a law out depending on who you are. Man say, well, you know what? Oh, you Beyonce, forget that ticket. I'll tear it up because of who you are. God is not going, because when God established something, it is good. It is just. He is justice. So therefore, that's why he said the wages of sin is death. He is justice. So therefore, somebody had to pay that price. That's why we love Christ so much. Because he paid the price. For every lie we told, for everything we ever did, for every time you had sex and you weren't married, Jesus took that price upon his body. It didn't just go away. He took it upon himself. Amen? Okay.
Verse 11, as a dog returns to his own vomit, so does a fool return to his folly.
How many of us get what he's saying? And I'm going to tell you, all of us in this room have to be very careful of this one right here. Serious. Because as a dog, meaning something that, what's interesting about that verse is, it was thrown out of him. It was purged out of him. That's why, how many of y'all ever heard of the saying, familiar spirits? A familiar spirit is something that's familiar to you because guess what? It was operating, you were operating in it. And to go back to that, it's like a dog returning to his vomit. When you go back to, let's say God delivered us from porn or delivered us from lust or whatever, and you begin to go back to it, you're beginning to eat, partake of that which was cleaned out of you. Amen? Amen. Go ahead. Come on. You okay?
They play awesome.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, all right. That was verse 11. As a dog returns to his vomit, so a fool returns to his folly. And that's disgusting, right? So I was like, okay, in the natural, because like I'm a biology major, so I'm like, okay, why does a dog return to its vomit? Because dogs do in real life. A dog returns to its vomit because, one, it's what its mom used to do. Basically, the mom would feed the pups by regurgitation. And then two, dogs have an increased olfactory cells, which are the cells that are in your nose, and they can smell food particles in their vomit. So one, it goes back to the old food, just like it goes back to what their mom used to do. And it's funny, like Apostle was saying, familiar spirits, because, like, you know, if you're raised up and you're everything about your family is get man, get money, get this. And when God begins to renew our mind in Romans 12:2 says, let your mind be renewed. And it talks about, in the Amplified version, it says new ideals and new attitudes. But when we don't allow our mind to be renewed, and even earlier when Apostle was talking about like all this stuff, you know, being able to separate yourself from the world and being in Christ, is like if you're not sitting there and you're not feeding. And I love what the thing is this year. It's called the Rising of the Sons. So it's not even the power, because I have heard someone who has the power and authority speaking on Moody and said that, you know, basically abortions, like there are Christians who are saved and believe in abortions, but that can't be so if you walk right into the Word of God and you have that relationship with Him. And then the second part was like how the dog goes back because of the increase, like they have the increased olfactory cells, which I told you was the smells in the nose. And it says the dog looks past the mess that is surrounding what they see, and they go back and find pleasure in the vomit. Because if you ever looked at vomit, vomit has little particles in it. And the dog will go back because it can have a strong smell to that. If you're used to something and you want to, it's basically like you would go back to it because you see something good in it, but it's still nasty. No matter how you fix it, how you make it. And like a lot of times I find myself, okay, let me go back to this. But then at the end of the day, I'm still dissatisfied because I know that it's nasty. So that's why sometimes I'm learning not to even play with a little bit of leaven, because it will leaven the whole lump. And the dog looks past the mess, but we have to remember that the sin that we fell into, that we keep falling over and over, and that's kind of what opened up my eyes to certain things I keep falling into, is that, yo, this is disgusting, because it brings me to a place of sadness. And especially if you have the Holy Ghost and you become grieved and you just running in a circle and a circle. So, and vomit is of no benefit.
I want to say this too. There was a key to that statement I want to thank Omar for breaking it down for us. I appreciate that. There was a key to that statement. It says, a fool. Look at somebody say, you're not a fool.
You're not a fool.
It said a fool returns. Everybody understand it? He's saying a fool. And remember, the Bible said, there's a fool that says there is no God. A fool returns back because he doesn't have the knowledge. You know what's funny? When we don't have God, we operate in our flesh, in our lower nature. You operate in a fleshly nature like an animal. When God is not in, when you and I operate in, and we operate according to our desires. But when you accept Christ and you are led by the Spirit, you're moving by wisdom and knowledge. You're moving by all who God is. Amen? And who God is, the wisdom of God will say, and I love how Omar said it, the wisdom of God, even though in that vomit there might be pieces of meat that dog can sense there's not, and he's trying to get something, he's delights in that. And even in that female, she might be fine. But the reality of it is, it leads to death for those who have wisdom. Everybody understand? To go back there is to lead. To go back to sin is to lead to death. To live beneath the life that God has designed for you and I. Amen? And I think sometimes we forget that. Sometimes somebody can forget the stink of our past. When we find ourselves playing with, when I say the stink of our past, because there was consequences to sin. Amen? But, and one thing about the enemy does, he likes to dress it up real nice. He'll dress it up in religion, in church going, but it's still vomit. Everybody, y'all with me? Okay.
Verse 12. Do you see a man who is wise in his own eyes? There is more hope for a fool than for him. All right, so do you see a man who's wise in his own eyes? A fool is someone who's like pretty much doing something that's not wise, or he's doing something that's ignorant. But a person who's thinking that he's wise in his own eyes, think that he's doing what's right. A fool is doing something, he probably doesn't know that he's doing it foolishly, but a person who is wise in his own eyes perceives that he's doing it the right way. And so it's saying that like there's more hope for a fool, because if that fool could be corrected, then he probably will begin to walk in the right way. But a man who already thinks that he's walking in the right way can't really be corrected. And it reminds me of like in the New Testament where Jesus is talking to the Pharisees, and he was like, I did not come to save those who are blind but think that they can see. I came to save those who are blind and desire sight. You know, I didn't come for the righteous, those who are wise in their own eyes. I came for the sinners. I didn't come for those who are well, right in their own eyes. I came for the sick. And so that verse to me is pretty much saying that if you are a fool, that means that there's hope for you. But if you already think that you've arrived, then there is not much hope for you.
Amen. And I'm going to tell you, that's why one of the hardest things to minister to are religious people. Jesus had a problem. When the Gentiles, they wanted to come. They wanted to hear the gospel. But religious people are so hard to minister to because they perceive what they have is right. When you think you're right, you're not open to learn in that area. You think you know already. So nobody can't really tell you anything because you think you already know. Amen? Who's Stacy? Okay, go ahead.
Allow God to deal with their situations in that Matthew 5 speak about that person who is in the church and he won't allow even his heart to be clean. And it says, Matthew 5 verse 22 says, but I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire.
Amen. Amen. I'm going to tell you another thing also about this scripture. This verse right here is so interesting, especially as being a pastor for some years, that I found interesting with people. Those who think they know, always pointing out at others, they can't see themselves. A fool can't, they can't see them. They always got something to say, and because they think they are in good standing with God, that's why I look at somebody and say, please stay humble. Because, and I think one of the greatest ways to stay humble is to put your, to know that you might be wrong. You might jump, see, because I don't see people like, hey, sweaty, why? You be like, no, you, and I because, you know, just don't argue with a fool. Just pray to God, because they be wrong. They and I'm not wrong because you feel they wrong because it doesn't line up with the word of God or what they saying. Amen? You can't hate your brother. You can't speak evil of your brother. That's wrong. That's not you're out of order. That's not in, so when we know the word of God, when you know the word of God and people talk, the Spirit of God is going to discern what people say, and you gotta be like, no, bro, that's not, no, I don't care what, no. Know that you, let me tell you something, I had to learn it. That's what I'm telling you. Know that you can be dead wrong. Amen. Amen. And when you know that you can be dead wrong, you are a person that's very cautious in your approach to people. When you open your mouth, you want a witness when you know that you can be dead wrong. Eli, the priest in the church, when Solomon was born, he was dead wrong. His perception of her mother was dead wrong. He thought she was drunk and someone said, no, it was wrong. And so can you be dead wrong. That's why be slow. God, give me a witness. God, give me understanding, because you don't want to be wrong and open your mouth, because you can cause people to stumble. You can wound people and hurt people. Be slow. Keep your mouth. Be slow. And to God, I want to know this you. Why? Because once you release it, either it's going to bring life or poison. And make sure that the word, this is what we got, everybody got to watch out for this too. Make sure that the word of God is not tainted by your own condition of your heart. Because a lot of times, your perception or what's going on can be tainted by what's going on in your life. How you see things. It's not how God sees things, it's how you see things. Because I have to believe that it was Eli, right? That there was something of Eli's perception. It wasn't just that he saw, like, it was something about his perception of how he saw certain things that made him so easy to perceive that in that way he perceived. We sometimes see things and we interpret sometimes based on our own perception. If you are a miserable person, your interpretation gonna always be miserable about people. It's the truth. I don't care if the person sitting there smiling, they got a half smile on their face. They like, if somebody could sit like, man, they going through. Your interpretation going to be miserable because you're going to entwine it with you. If you are know-it-all, your interpretation going to be. That's why it's good to stay humble. Why? Because when you stay humble, God can give you the interpretation. Because I'm gonna tell you, I think I just wanted to stay for a minute. Because I know, because I know one time I was like angry in my heart, and I had to tell myself, I was like, wait a minute, hold up. I said, this is what I told God. Honestly, I said, God, I don't trust my heart at this point right now to go say that. I don't trust. In other words, I didn't trust my heart to release that at that point because I knew in my heart I was going through some things at that point. I didn't trust my heart really to. So I was like, God, I'm going to stay before you a little long. You know what I'm saying? To the place where you know your heart goes. Because the bottom line is, I'm telling you, people who are miserable will interpret everything miserable. People who are wounded and broken, they will interpret everything through their wounds and their brokenness. Because this is what I learned. Sometimes, even in dreams or certain situations, sometimes it's not even about the whole dream. It can be so about a small part of a dream. Sometimes it's about the course of a dream. Sometimes the dream is about you. And the action in the dream is showing you how you respond to things. That's why I learned. Let me get before. Because God gives the interpretation. Let me get before. Why? So I can understand. Because people have dreams. I'm telling you the truth. You can have dreams. Somebody can have dreams about somebody. Let's say you can have dreams about somebody having sex. And it has nothing to do with sex. It has to do with covenant. You can have dreams about somebody touching something. And it has nothing to do with, it has nothing to, too many people interpret. Every time they see something, they think it's about sex. No, everything is not about sex. Sometimes it's about what sex stands for. You got to know. That's why you got to let God interpret it. Because I remember one time, God showed me a dream. And it was about oral sex in a dream. But it was not about oral sex. It was about how somebody's mouth, he was talking to me. When I woke up, I said, God, what is this about? He said, the way they use their mouth is out of order. Ask God. And don't open your mouth until he releases it. Don't tell nobody. Go. The Bible says God interpret dreams. What good is telling somebody else the dream if God didn't interpret it? Or, and if God did give you the interpretation, then it's only for the person who is the dream is about. Go ahead, Bob.
And I think sometimes why that happens is because people like to seem important and like they have, you know, deep revelation. Like, God speak to me. Let me show you what God told me about this person. And it just reminded me of something that we talked about at a women's meeting where the Bible says, confess your sin one ye to another. Like, confess your sin. Don't confess somebody else's sin for them, okay? Because that's their responsibility to do it, you know? So if you're sinning, if you have a dream about yourself, go ahead, if God leads you to talk about it, but dreaming about other people and saying, girl, come on, I had this dream about Watley over here. Child, he out of order. You know, like, that's not my place to do that. Why does Gamal need to know? I can go to Watley and say, hey, is everything okay? Because, you know, I had this dream and I prayed about it and God led me to speak to you about it. And I wanted to read something from Luke chapter 18. And it says, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of what I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Amen.
Remember, I want to say this also. If God unfolds something to you, then that means he trusts you to pray. Let me tell you something. Pray is not the last thing you do. It's the most powerful thing you can do. Jesus went in the garden and he began to pray. Communication with God is the most powerful thing. And to pray in behalf of somebody, the Bible says the sincere prayers of the righteous prevail much. If God reveals them to you, that means he trusts you to be, that your heart will go and pray out and pour out before that person so much that God will move in their behalf. If you are a slanderer, God probably ain't talking to you. If you are a backbiter, those dreams ain't coming from God. Why would God give you something and know you're going to murder your sister and your brother?
Like, as he was saying that, like, it reminded me of the scripture where Jesus said, I no longer call you a servant, I call you a friend. For a servant doesn't know his master's business, but a friend knows everything that the Father tells me, I tell you. And what is a friend? A friend is someone who's loyal, someone who's trustworthy, someone who's reliable. So Jesus is not going to give you a dream of someone else knowing that you're not a friend, knowing that you're not trustworthy and reliable with that information. So he still sees you as a servant, like you still have some maturity to go through before he can call you a friend and share certain things with you.
Amen. Go ahead. Let's go.
Verse 13, the lazy man says, there's a lion in the road. There's a fierce lion at that, a fierce lion in the streets.
Okay. A lazy man said there's a lion in the road. Yeah. If he's so lazy, how he know? I don't know. You know, I wouldn't too much on a lazy person who is not going to put any effort into doing anything, you know.
Yeah. So, like for me, when I read that, a lazy man says there's a lion in the road. The key point of that verse is that he's lazy. So a person who's lazy doesn't want to do anything. He's going to make excuses for him not to be able to do those things. So for him to say there's a lion outside, there probably isn't one, but he's making an excuse so that he can stay indoors. And sometimes we can be lazy by making excuses for the things that we're supposed to do, the things that we believe God is calling us to do. God may say, oh, like, I'm calling you to, to pray. Oh, God, I can't pray. Like, it's too early. And, oh, I'm convincing myself.
Now you know how I feel. Be preaching. It be talking about ouch. You know what I'm saying? Okay, Lord, I got you. Go. So I think somebody.
My God. Okay. So yeah, I'm done. Yeah.
It's true. It's true though. It's true. It's true.
Yeah.
Hi, some of y'all been wanting to exercise. Talking about it was too cold this morning. Okay.
I just had a quick question, because when I was doing my reading, I kind of wasn't really comprehending why they would bounce between the lazy man and the slothful man. So I just hope when you get there that you could, like...
The difference between somebody...
Because it bounces between lazy and slothful. Every other verse, it seemed like. You know what I mean?
Let's look them up. Let's look up slothfulness. Because I think they, are they interchangeable? It seems like they're interchangeable.
It seems like it could be used interchangeably. A slothful person is someone who's lazy, idle,
it's just,
inactive.
They're interchangeable. It's just, I don't know why sometimes they use it, but I know they basically mean the same. So, okay. Let's go. We're gonna finish 26 today. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. So number 14.
Hold up, Linda wanted to say something. You wanna say something? You as what? Okay, thank you.
Verse 14. As the door turns on its hinges, so does the lazy man on his bed.
So we don't go on from fools to lazy people. Go ahead.
Yeah. I thought it was funny because when I read it, I was thinking of like the hinges of a door. When you open it, it looked like it's going somewhere, but then it comes right back. So it's like, oh, I'm going to get out. I'm a jog today. Wait, no, it's cold. So it's just like, that's what I thought about.
Amen. And I'm going to tell you something. We and it's good to laugh, but man, we all can be lazy in certain areas. You know what I'm saying? And one thing about being lazy in certain areas, we don't accomplish. Some of us, this is what I feel in my spirit. I'm gonna say this: some of us in this room talking about you waiting on God. And God been like, I've been waiting for you for the last 5 years. God has done everything. You God has done it and made it straight. You just being lazy about the fact that, man, God say I'm gonna be a God say I'm gonna have a lot of money. God say I'm gonna have a whole lot of money. I'm gonna be. Look, Rosella, put your hand down, man. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? You need to be saved. You know what I'm saying? No, check this out. God say I'm gonna have a whole lot of money, right? But then I'm not gonna get into it, but it's interesting. When you go to Proverbs 27, especially at the end. It's interesting because sometimes we say, God say, I'm going to have a whole lot of money. But we forget about the work you need to do first. Before you start, you don't want to put the work in. You got to, there's a work ethic. You got to, there's some, come on. I know a lot of you think God's going to just drop down money from heaven. And listen, let me say something. I'm not saying God can't drop down money from heaven. He rained down manna so he can, God can do whatever he want to do. You know? But even if he dropped it down, you still got to pick it up. Y'all get what I'm saying? You still got to pick it up. There's going to be some that they're going to fade. You got to take what God, you have to apply what God is saying. You have to exercise what God is telling you to do. Amen. God, you want to say something? Come on. I'm serious about this because I do want to talk about this for a second because the bottom line is you waiting on God. If God is saying, what you waiting on? Faith is obedience, doing what the Word of God tell you to do.
Go ahead. All right, so this is a door, right? Hopefully it's unlocked. Oh, no, it's not, right? Okay. Let's pretend this door is unlocked, right? And then I'm opening it and I'm closing it. Like the door is moving, but it's not going anywhere. So even when a lazy man is on his bed, he's moving, turning left and right, but he's really not going anywhere, right? You know? Like he can be like, oh, I'm just tired or whatever. And it's like our bed could be whatever is comfortable to us. So even though we could be doing things, we're not really progressing or going anywhere because we're comfortable swaying side to side, and we feel like we're doing something, we feel like we're being productive, but we're really stagnant.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, we got our faith. The Bible says faith without works is what? Dead. You got to do some application. Amen.
Amen.
You sitting there, you know, your arm rotten, you might want to go to the doctor. And God can, you know, if you pray, you might want to go to the doctor, you know. I remember one time my pastor Screech, he hear me laughing. He said he ran into a dude in the mall, right? Dude got a cast on his arm. To my, yeah, man, I'm healed. No, bro, your arm broken. You know what I'm saying? Stop tripping. Your arm broken. It's not the bottom line is you got a cast in your arm is broken and it's being healed. God can do something. He can put mud on you. God can move any way God wants to. He can move through a doctor. Amen. Amen. Don't be like that person who was in the water. They fell and they drowned, and God sent the little boat to my, no. Send my middle boat, no. Send another boat, no. They drowned. God, why you ain't saved me? God, I don't know if God would have said, fool, I sent you three boats. What you was waiting on? I don't know if God would have said. But it's like, what you waiting on? God give you, there are things that you're going to have to do. I remember one time, Prophet Scopeland preached a message a long time talking about the practical. There's some practical things you're going to have to do. Yes. Amen. Amen. Go ahead. Come on.
I can relate to that because sometimes that, you know, just like Apostle say, and it's been like 10 years and God was asking me to do something, but I was fighting it. My flesh was like, you know, this is not, you know, what I want to do and stuff like that. And to the other day, it was like I was tired, you know. He used a young lady to tell me that, Paula, one thing I know about you, you love God, but you be fighting God a lot. And then she was like, no man fight God and win. And to the other day, I was like, it been like 10 years since I've been fighting God in that, you know, and that word. Because I know, you know, it was God because I was talking to Stacey on the phone because I was like, I was tired, you know. You know, when you fight so much, you like, man, I surrender, I'm tired, you know. I was in the phone, I was like, man, God, I'm tired. Whatever you want me to do, I do it. And till I say it, that I feel like it was like something broke in heaven. It was like the door just start opening before me and stuff like that. Even the other day, I didn't know that, you know, I have, you know, doctoral things inside of me. It was like they was giving me a lot of tests that I never go to school for. I was like, man, I was trying to find people to help me. You know, I said, where's the iron? I need somebody to help me and stuff like that. God shut every door. And then he locked me in the womb by myself. It was like I mean, that like a, it was like a lot of tests. Like, and I feel like my brain was one. I said, man, I don't know nothing about this kind of test. I never go to school. And then and I even called those people. I said, this is for our NN doctors. I said, what y'all doing? And they was like, man, they give it to everybody. They just, you know, testing your knowledge. I'm like, man, God, you know. He was like, he moving everybody out of the way. I can't find nobody to help me. And then while I was in the womb and I was in the computer, and it was like a long thing up there. One got 100 questions. They finished have you watching some video and then they haven't, you know, giving you tests. Then I have like 14, you know, certificate when I finish, you know, those tests. It was like I was just sitting in there. I didn't know that what I was doing, but each and every one of them, they're like 100, you know, you passed it. You passed this test. It was like my brain. I was holding my brain. I said, God, I feel like, you know, you waking me up because I never see them. I never study for it. It's just like to just letting you know that, you know, when you allow God, you will, because he put things inside of you. And then I let the enemy fight me for so long, like, oh, you dumb. You know, you will never accomplish to nothing, you know. Since I was a little girl, they told me that, oh, you're not smart and stuff like that. That's keeping me from not going to school. And then God is calling me from the medical field. And I fight this thing for so long. Right now, I'm at Nutshell Hospital. It was like, you know, I said, God, man, it was like things was, Not even that. The Lord bought me uniform. I didn't even have to pay for uniform. I didn't have to pay for my shoes. I didn't have to pay for nothing. It was like things was moving. Boom, boom, door. Money was coming. I was like, man, just to letting you know that, like Apostle said, that, you know, sometimes that, you know, because, and then those things that I was suffering because of my, I didn't want to do what God calling me to do. And then, like, I mean, that he said, God is waiting on you to say, yes, Lord. That day when I said, God, whatever you want me to do, I will never procrastinate, you know. It was like, that's what I wanted to say, because, you know, sometimes, you know, you don't have, you're going through, yes, but God, you know, he wants you to be somewhere. He wants you to do something. Even today that I ministered to, I mean, a couple of people at the hospital, outside, this girl don't have no place to go. She was homeless. They sent me to the behavior, the people that they mind is going crazy and stuff like that. I was like, man, you know, I don't even, you know, I don't have nothing else to say. It's just like, it's amazing.
And just know this, it doesn't have to look like it when God tell you to do something. Just do it. You don't have to have all faith come by hearing the word of God. Then you have to do the word of God. You gotta step out of faith. You gotta do it. And God will let you know, man, when it's God, it's certain things, doors gonna, I mean, it's gonna, you're gonna know. God sending you, you're gonna know. Because God gives you favor. With man, and you have it with man and God when you're moving in that direction of God. Amen? Come on, favor to the place where he'll split a red. Come on. God will split a Red Sea open to get you to his death. If he told you to go in that destination. Amen? Come on. He said, he told them to go around that way. They got an ocean in front of them. God said, don't worry about that. If I told you to go that way, that ocean got to move. Because God is not a man that should lie, or the Son of Man has to lie. If God said it, it might look impossible for you, but there's nothing that God says is possible for God. And a lot of times when God may say something to you and I that looks impossible, he wants to build up your faith. He wants to build up your faith. Amen? God wants to build up your faith. He wants to build up your faith.
My God.
Amen. My God. Amen. You got it?
Amen.
Go ahead.
I'm thinking about, still remain on the scripture about being lazy. Like, I'm thinking of, like, what he said about the Red Sea split in half. Like, God brought them out of Egypt, which is a place of sin and bondage, across the Red Sea. But he didn't want to just bring them across the Red Sea and then that's it. Like, he wanted to get them to the promised land. But if they were lazy, they would have been like, okay, I did just enough. You know, I got saved. I crossed over to the other side from death to life. I'm a Christian now, so I'm going to be lazy. I'm going to just wait until Jesus Christ come back to take me to heaven. Like, no, like, we can't be lazy. In your waiting, you have to be proactive. In your waiting, you have to work until he comes back. You have to occupy until he comes back. Like, God has a destination for us while we're on earth. So we can't just be lazy and say, oh, I crossed the Red Sea, you know, I'm saved now, so I'm straight. I'm going to be lazy. That's like the lazy man with the talent who buried it. God was like, no, I want to take you to the promised land so I can set you up so that you can be the light to those who are around you so that you can fulfill your purpose and minister to them. So that's another way that we have to make sure that we're not being lazy in our assignment and in our purpose to glorify God and ministering to people and leading them to him.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Let's keep on going. Let's close it out. I mean, we got a little more going on.
Verse 15. The lazy man buries his hand in the bowl, but it wearies him to bring it back up to his mouth.
It's right there. You know what I'm saying? Okay, keep going. Yeah.
Verse 16. The lazy man is wiser in his own eyes than seven men who can answer sensibly.
Always trying to get over. Lazy, but always trying to get over. You know what I'm saying? They wise and they always, always trying to get over. Amen? He wise in his own life because he, especially when you talk about somebody that's lazy, one reason, because they got a lot of excuses why they can't accomplish what everybody else is trying, what everybody else is doing. Everybody see what I'm saying? He got a lot of excuses to stay in that situation. Go ahead.
Verse 17, he who passes by and meddles in a quarrel, not his own, is like one who takes a dog by the ears.
Oh yeah, that's a good one right there. Read it, break it down for us.
Easy to read version. Yeah.
What verse? 17.
To step between two people who are arguing is as foolish as going out into the street and grabbing a stray dog by his ears.
You can't get no plainer than that, right?
Yeah. And pretty much.
Go ahead.
Verse 18. Like a madman who throws firebrands, arrows, and death, is the man who deceives his neighbor and says, oh, I was only joking.
Is a man who deceives his neighbor and says, I was only joking. Look at somebody say, don't be playing games.
I wish I had my Bible app, but my phone's about to die. Really? Oh, you're so kind. Thank you. Okay. It's in the book of Ephesians. Chapter 5, verse 4. Hold on, I'm going to find Ephesians chapter 5, verse... Oh, yours is really cool. Okay. Where is it? Okay. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 4 says, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse joking, which are not fitting, but rather... giving of thanks, for this you know. Oh, sorry. But the coarse joking talk is like when people play around and they be like, okay, like let's say if I just get a job. Girl, you think you all that because you got a new job. Just kidding. No, you really meant that. And it's from your heart. That's coarse joking. Don't play. Oh, you got a new car. You think you brand new. No. I'm just kidding. No, you're not. You're speaking from the abundance of your heart. And that's coarse joking. Like, don't play around with that. Like, you seriously have a heart issue right now. But.
So if you say to somebody like, you since you don't have no job, you're not my daughter no more. I was like, you like being serious? Okay. All right.
Yeah, there's always a little truth behind every just kidding.
Okay.
Okay, I kind of have a question because I'm a real big jokester, I should say. Like, not in the way, I understand in the way she say it, right? But I know, like, I had an older brother and we play fight. We always used to joke, so I want to know if I'm, because Tina be like, you play so much, but like, some things I'll be like, it. Like, for example, well, no, I'm not going to use that example. Because it ended up really happening. But, like, I'll be like, oh my goodness. Like, I'll be like, I'm trying to think of one, like, that. All right, I'm going to just put myself out, right?
Trying to think of one and one make it good.
All right, listen, okay. So I was going through, like, a lot of persecution when I was working at Dunkin' Donuts. And I was like, every day I'm just going through. And I don't know why, right? I just play a lot, I guess I should say, right? So I called Tina, and I was like, girl, oh my goodness, why they tried me? They beat me. They punched me dead in my face like they beat me up. Girl, why they tried to jump me? Like, I ain't do nothing to these people, right? And Tina like, what? Like, you for real? You for real? So I get to the corner. Tina done walked all the way out the house, around the corner, up to the street. And then I was like, I was like, "Sag, nah, girl, I was just playing, girl."
I know, but you should never tell me that one right there, huh?
Ooh. But it really ended up, like, it really actually ended up happening, but for God's glory, oh God, I'm embarrassed. Ah! No, but it really, for God's glory, though, you know.
Don't give us that pipe. She's talking about for God's glory.
But no, my question is, though, like, I know I played.
No, listen.
You know,
listen,
but I don't.
I think a person knows their heart, because the truth is, in that situation, somebody can, like, some of y'all are saying, some of y'all, you know who you're talking to. In other words, there's somebody that you know, that's your friend, the person that loves you, and they have nothing behind that joke at all. They do not have anything behind that joke. That's, they, you know them, they know you. Because I don't want, because some of us, like, you know, some of y'all, you know, we going to feed on that. Yeah, that's how people not being real. People don't be real in your face. Well, no, if you find a little excitement in that, you might want to examine yourself. Because don't go around thinking everybody trying to attack you either. Some people do kid if joke. Some people do kid. But people just sensitive in their own way. Man, people, you know, but the fact is, because, and I don't say that to take away from, it's what it's saying is true, but and I thank Tracy for making that point. But someone can joke with someone, and in their heart, they had no malice in their heart at all. That's just how they play. That's how they know each other. You know what I'm saying? That's how they know each other. Go ahead.
This is a clarification. Previously, it does says a madman throwing arrows, like it's somebody that is using something that it's like words. A word is very, it can hurt you, like it can pierce you, and it's somebody using it recklessly. So just be right. Mindful of that. Like, it's not somebody that you know. It's someone that could be, like, from afar, like, where you come at with that? Like, we were talking about cookies and milk. Like, where'd you come from coming with this whole conversation? Like, are you mad about something? Like, you can tell. Like, you can discern and see it. So,
and especially in a time where everybody thinks somebody might be trying to throw shade. You know, like, what?
Okay, and I think, too, with this verse, it's basically where when we're doing things wrong, basically like deceiving or stealing from somebody, and then we get caught, and we just say, I'm just playing, man, you know, here you go, you know? Like, yeah. I think that's what it's kind of...
Oh. Y'all know that. You know that one here, right at home. Especially if you're married. Girl, you know I was joking. I ain't really mean that. Sure you did. You got caught. You know what I'm saying? Go ahead. Yes.
I just wanted to know, basically, how far can you go with the joke? Like, within the, you know, the godly perspective. For example, like, yesterday, I was talking to a couple of friends, and then I said something like my spiritual leaders, he prophesied, he always be like, man, I don't know you. He always say like that, and it's a funny way. So I was moved by the Spirit, and then I said something to this person. I said, I don't know you. And I was kind of like, you know, not mocking him in a bad way, but later on, I kind of felt convicted. I felt convicted when I was in the shower. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm mocking the man of God. You know what I'm saying? Even though it was innocent, but like, I want to know how far do you go as far as that?
Okay, yeah. I think you answered it by your conviction. Because the truth be told, I thank God. Because I know we have some sitting in the audience that like to play games when an apostle be preaching or something, and like that. Well, you better hope God don't come and begin to drop the hammer on you while you. I'm gonna tell you something. Let me be honest about that. Be very careful with that. I'm just being honest. Be very careful with that, because let me tell you why. Be very careful with it. If you're joking with somebody that's sitting beside you, with somebody that's not there, and you and him, let's say you and that leader cool. You know what I'm saying?
you can change somebody else's perspective in that situation. And you built a relationship like that where they may be look, sit back and relax with you a little bit, but you got to be very careful with that. Be very careful with that because familiarity. And because I know I like, personally, I'm me. I like the joke. I like the trip out. I like the joke trip out. When I'm not joking, you're going to know I'm not joking. And when I'm not tripping, you're going to know I'm not tripping.
You're going to know.
And I'm not going to come at you and know, let you know I'm not tripping and I'm not joking in a way where I'm going to try to disrespect you or dishonor you. But the bottom line is, I think it's okay to be light and people get to know you and they laugh at you. But don't ever get it comfy. See, I think sometimes in ministry, I'm going to tell you, let me put it this way. I love everybody. Man, it's in my heart to love everybody in this room. Don't get it twisted with the position I walk in because the fact is, number one, because see, you got people who don't mind putting their mouth on people. You got people who don't mind giving their opinions and their thoughts about situations against authority. God call them brute beasts. In other words, a leader say something and they think they have no fear in opening their mouth and begin to talk and evaluate what they perceive that leader. And actually, they should have fear. They should not because of leader, they should have fear. Because the reality of that situation, there's a way you do things in order. And but I think every leader has to understand this. No leader should be looking for the validation of people. I love everybody here, but I'm not. If people don't like me, or people, if they don't love me, or they don't agree with me, I'm not. You're not agreeing with me, or not liking what I'm saying. I'm not going to stop preaching and stop doing what I'm saying because you didn't. You have no authority in assigning me. You have no authority in sitting me down. But in that situation, because you gonna, the reason I'm saying this to people, the reason I'm saying this because you always have people who have an opinion, who think they should be in a position, who think that, their backbiting ways show that that's why God would never put them in any further. Why? Because the fact is, they lead with their emotions instead of with the word of God. So when I just say be very careful in that situation. You know what I'm saying? Just be very careful in that situation because you don't want someone else to take lightly that man of God when he's prophesying. You don't want somebody to take lightly that man of God when he's prophesying because if he's speaking in behalf of God, for him to take it lightly could cause him to miss something. That's all. Okay? That's all I'm saying. Okay, go ahead, Linda.
Good evening, family.
Good evening.
Okay, the reason why I'm coming up here to touch on this, because it's been like a year, and I've been praying for a door to speak on it, and just apostle right now, like speaking on it, I know it was like a burden in my heart. It was like, now is the time to speak on it. And because the way, like, the two words is reverence and honor. Even when it comes not only to leaders, but also to one another. And I thank God for Apostle, Prophet Barber, Pastor Bobby as our leaders. Thank God we don't have a pastor that's so serious and they can't joke around. But it was a time where it was such a burden and the Lord was allowing me to see the lack of reverence and honor we have for our leaders. You know, because there's been situations and I'll just see it where even with course joking, like, talking out loud. It was times where other visitors or maybe other men and women of God, they'll come in this place and it'll be outbursts. And God was not pleased with that because it shows, like, to the eyes of others, like, okay, how are their children like responding? There is a lack of reverence and of fear. So when I look up reverence just for one another as well, it's not just the leaders or like the man of God, but we should reverence and honor each other because it shows that we reverence and honor God. And let me just read out reverence. Okay, reverence, a deep respect for someone or something. And it talks about admiration, appreciation, favor, regard, or treat with deep respect, honor, a high respect, esteem, privilege, regarding someone with high esteem and respect. So even when it comes to that, like to really, I'm telling you, it was such a burden on my heart. And then, and I think I mentioned to Apostle about it before, but it was never like one of those, like you're not just going to speak. You just, if it's one person you see acting a certain way, hey, you know, you shouldn't talk like that or whatever. But I know God is not pleased in a sense where like they're not our friends. You know what I'm saying? Like they can be friends, but it's like they're not equal to us in a sense. Do you guys understand? It's like God has placed them above us, and they should have a level of honor and respect. And that's it.
I want to say this, too, also to understand that. I look at sometimes like family with my daughters in my home. With my daughters, I love my daughters. I joke with my daughters. Because love is being able to joke and to laugh, but to be able to be stern and to be firm, and to be understood that in that situation. I think, I also have to say I apologize, because I think sometimes me, and God, believe me, I've been rebuked. I take things lightly sometimes in a situation that make people feel like that they can act that way or joke that way. And then I have to let them know, no, you can't joke and play like that in that situation. So if anybody ever felt that it was on my behalf, I want to apologize in that situation, because number one, I don't want you ever to feel like you can disrespect this I'm a son, but there's an office and position that I walk in that don't disrespect that office and position that I walk in. Because that office and position, the office and position I walk in is not one that I established, it's one that God established. And so I think it, you know, God, I think it's a good evening for God to kind of, because I've had it. I'm gonna tell you something. I find it funny that people love you until you let them know what time it is. They let you know, one thing, the new me, see, I think some people, what they have taken as a weakness in the new me is that I'm not gonna argue with you no more. I used to sit there and go back with you and let you run your mouth. I'm not gonna do it. Because I've learned to let God deal with my God will fight the battle. I'm not going to stand toe to you when I'm gonna say A, B, C, then I'm going about my, because anybody know the me, I'm like, hey, I'm gonna say, boom, I'm gonna sit there, go, no, I'm not gonna dispute with you. And if God don't put it in my heart to sin, I'm not gonna sin him, because what I found out in my years, and I say this to you all as disciples, what I found out, can't nobody clean house like God. People be doing things, and they think God don't see them. And they get mad, and some of y'all realize, God will clean his house out before he allow discord to raise up, before he allow rebellion to raise up, before he allow you to raise up in a situation. And he showed it to me. Because there were moves that God did in his ministry that I went behind doing, and he did it. Matter of fact, I would have never known that person was thinking that or feeling that or doing that. He knew it. And God says, because if you're not going to be in alignment with God, you're going to be, God is going to escort you out. Because you ain't, if this was my church, then I'd be sitting here stressed out, worried about, you know, if you're trying to bring discord here, if you're sitting here trying to give your opinion, but I sleep good at night because it's not my church. It's God's church. And I'm going to tell you something. You can't hide, you, me, you cannot hide from God. And God, but see, the reason I love God, because God does it in such a loving way. Yeah, I remember one time somebody was texting, and somebody else got the text. What God do? He'll do it in a loving way. You know why? Because he exposed you and give you a chance to repent and give it right. And if you don't, then he going to, watch this, I don't have no message of condemnation for you. He going to tear your butt up and remove you. But even in that, I hope salvation come. Because you can't, because, you know, I believe, because when God is trying to, this is a hospital, and you can't taint people with the poison in your heart. Because, you know, honestly, man, I honestly, you know, I was telling somebody just this week, I'm waking up, I'm sleeping. And I hear this in my spirit. Lord, build a fence all around me every day. Lord, protect me as I travel on my way. And I'm hearing God. So when God's talking like this, you know something going on. You know something. When God is saying in your spirit, build a fence, I'm building a fence around, I'm about to protect you, because God's knowing that somebody plotting. Somebody got a scheme. Somebody getting ready to do something. So guys, what is God saying to the person? I got you covered in a fence. I got a fence around you covered. They're not going to be able to touch you. And I see them. So I go in, I say, Lord, I pray for them because they, know why? Because they fools. You say, what? Yeah, they fools because they don't realize they're not battling against me. They're battling against God. So you pray for people and you love on people, because what happens is you can't let your heart become bitter and angry toward people. Yeah, I heard this pastor say one thing, but I don't believe. This pastor say for every 12, it's going to be a Judas. But the reason I thought when he said that, I wouldn't have said it the way he said that for one reason. Because Judas was chosen just to usher you to your place, your higher place in God. Amen? So, and I'm saying this, but I'm saying it as in your personal life. Because, you know, people, I'm going to tell you something. People sitting in the church, even right now, you got cliques. You only love certain people who love you. You don't reach out to them. And you wrong. You in error. You think everybody got something against you. You down with only who you want to be down with. You are in absolute error. But God is going to help you. God is going to help you. Yeah, people come to church, they judging everybody. They judging everybody else, but can't see the beam in their own eye. Everybody else ain't right, but they right. Man, stay humble. Stay humble. And one thing, love your brothers and sisters. Love them like Christ loved you. Amen? And you will do good. Love them like Christ loved you. And you'll be good. And last but not least, we're going to call them, stay in your lane. Stay in your lane. Because you got people sometimes, they in everybody else's lane. They done took authority on themselves. They ain't got authority. Some people, you don't have authority to be counseling people. Stay in your lane. Walk in the authority that God gave you. Stay in your lane. I can't go to my office and tell Michelle what to do. I got to stay in my lane. Stay in your lane. Amen? Husbands and wives, even in the family, watch this. If a wife try to move outside her lane with her husband, that's out of order. If a husband try to move, husband can't be acting like the kids, that's out of order. And God is a God who loves order. This is kind of, because I'm telling you, I see, you know, y'all don't see, we see in ministry, they anoint somebody for women's ministry. They anoint somebody for women's ministry. She's the woman's ministry over there. And then you have somebody, well, I don't like this situation, so I'm going to start my women's, I'm going to start one over here. That's out of order. That's out of order. And I'm going to tell you why that, let me tell you why God likes order. You know who had a spirit like that? Satan. Satan had a spirit that caused him to say and took one third of the angels out of order, saying, I could do this better. It should be done this way. I think if God wanted to be done the way he done, he would have gave you the authority to do it. Amen. And I think, come on. I think this is a good, y'all may not think this is a good conversation to have in this Proverbs, but it really is, because sometimes when we talk about being a fool and foolish and being, these things comply in this, having that type of wisdom. Go ahead.
What I wanted to say was to piggyback off what Apostle was saying, because when you, especially with me, and I'm the biggest joker in my household when it comes to me, my sister, my mom. I'm the one that's always making all the jokes. But there has to be a level of respect and a level of accountability where you cannot say certain things. And even if it's in your heart, you have to let God deal with you. Because when it comes on to even going against the authority, that is straight rebellion against God himself. If you are against something that Apostle is doing and God led Apostle to do that, you are against God himself. And you have to be very careful with that, because then you start moving in another spirit where you start saying, oh, well, I think Apostle's doing this wrong or doing this incorrectly, and I'm just going to do my own thing. That's not how it works with God. Especially when you're in a ministry, you have to be in order. And even with me, I trust me, I understand when it's like, when you're like, man, I'm trying to grow, I'm trying to mature and stuff like that. I understand. But there has to be order. If not, everything falls apart. We are a body. That means we need to work together. And there's nothing worse than when you allow the enemy to come in you and start division in a ministry. And you may not understand the depth of it, of how much it can affect, because I've seen it firsthand what it can do to a ministry. It's not pretty. And then for it to get back together when it could have just been flourishing all along, it's just a whole big setback. But just allow God to convict you. And as for your question, as far as how far to go, if you get that conviction, then you go with that conviction. That's when you know when to stop. So that's what I have to say, because even when the Apostle was saying, there is sometimes a lack of respect for the authority, and it's not okay. It really isn't. So that's what I wanted to say.
While you guys were speaking, Apostle and the two sisters, the Lord really ministered unto me. It's crazy. For the last 2-3 weeks, I've been like dealing with ministering to me about joking, and I'm so happy I came here tonight, because I'm like, man, I don't like, you know, I'm not sure, Lord, is it okay to joke or whether to joke? And that incident that happened last night is I mocked the man, you know what I'm saying? Even though it was innocent, and it was just like on the spot moment, it wasn't no ill thing or nothing like that, but I mocked him. And it's mocking is not good, you know? And I always remember that verse where it says, you cannot mock God, you will reap what you sow. You know what I'm saying? And it just was ministering unto me. And I remember the story, I don't know if you guys read in 2 Kings. Where is it? Oh, yeah, I'll just tell it to y'all, basically. 2 Kings, I think it's 2, verse 23, it talks about Elijah, and when he was basically going up, and then a whole bunch of kids, 42 kids came and said, man, Baldy, go up the baldy, you know what I'm saying? And he cursed them, and two bears came and killed all the kids. And I was the man of God, and I used to be like, Lord, there was kids. Like, there was children. God didn't rebuke Elijah, nothing. He went on his way to go do the work of the Lord. And it made me understand the seriousness of mocking God's authority. That's the image of God. And, you know, like, I'm one of the big jokers too in my whole family, you know what I'm saying? And I joke with my dad and my mom all the time and my brothers and sisters. But when it came to the man of God, I was like, oh, my God, oh, my goodness. I couldn't go to sleep and all that. I'm just like, I'm serious. And it's like, and I'm in the shower thinking about it. And it just, you know, I'm happy I came here today. And the Lord gave me comfort in knowing that conviction. And it just let me realize that authority God puts over us, that's God's word. And that's God's people right there. You know what I'm saying? We are God's children, but he sets, like, even think about Moses. And his sister and his brother, they had an opinion, and they got cursed. You know what I'm saying? And I actually know men and women of God. I know men of God. This actually happened to where people spoke against them, and bad stuff happened to these people. So that fear and reverence was in me, and that's why it was bothering me for the last 3 weeks. Like, oh my, you know, and my answer was, don't mess with the people of God. Don't mess with his authority. If you know he a man of God especially, respect them, have that honor. And I got that answer today as the Lord ministered unto me. It's you know, among our brothers and sisters, it's okay as far as certain jokes, but don't come around this. You know what I'm saying? Like, seriously, don't come around this right here. You know what I'm saying? So I just praise God for that. Hallelujah.
I want y'all to notice that and I don't have a. I say this. How many of us was here last week? Remember when we was here last week? God shifted last week, didn't he? God said, we was rejoicing in the shifting last week. He shifted this week too. He did. And he's not shifting because he's mad at us. He's shifting it to bring order with us. So it's a good thing. And that's why I have to say, when you speak, I do have to say this. And I want to say to God, and I want to say to everybody in this room, I apologize. No, and I take that to my shoulders. I apologize because if God shifted, and I'm convicted in myself, and I'm convicted in myself because I let some people feel like it was that you know, I joked with you to the place where you felt comfortable to say what you wanted to say when you wanted to say it. If I made you feel that way, then I apologize because that's absolutely unacceptable, and I will not. Through the Spirit of God, and that don't mean I'm about to become this.
Jesus bless you. You know what I'm saying?
That doesn't mean I'm become this rigid person, but I'm not going to take lightly that which God has called me to walk in to the place where somebody else becomes to stumble because they think they can say or act any type of way in this situation. Because I wanted to be the first to say. Because, you know, I apologize in that situation to everybody here in that manner. And as one who is being led by the Spirit, you know, what I love about us as being family, we joke, we want to make sure we keep it to a place where there's honor and respect for everybody. You know what I'm saying? And do it in a way, and when it's about God's business, we're going to be about God's business. Amen?
Okay. So basically, I know it was God that set up this situation because God always tells me to pray, and I always feel like I'm not doing a good job or it's not enough. And yesterday, I prayed for like 30 minutes, an hour, but then like it just kind of like that little bit of prayer and being obedient to God, it just kind of like he was able to send the Holy Spirit to speak to me. And basically, when I was meditating today, like at home, like, cause I've been trying to just stay, like keep calm, like always keep calm and like meditate and just so I can hear when God speaks. And basically like how this whole situation got set up with Linda talking and everybody else and then Apostle saying what he said, was God just basically told me that just who's going to stand for Apostle? Like, who's going to pray for him? My God. Who's going to fight for him? Because I said, God was like, he's been doing this so long. He's been fighting so long that who's going to reach out and pray for him? And God just led me to ask all you guys to stand up and just basically just to reach out and to pray for him and to give him strength, because it's been a long time. And it's like he does all of this for us, and he's, you know, he let God lead him to speak to us. And, you know, like, you know, who's going to give him the respect to pray for him and really reach out for him and to stand for him? And God just, it was just that little moment, and the way he set up everything, I just know that it's God and it's his will. And I knew, like, I had to stand up and say it. So that's it. So I just asked for you guys to, like, if we could just take a couple minutes or whatever to just pray for Apostle.
Well, we're going to, since you told you to do it, you're going to lead us in prayer, right?
Oh, my God.
Amen. Go ahead.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the work that you're doing, Father, in this ministry, Lord. Lord, I just thank you for this man of God, Father God, that you sent him to give your word, Lord, that we may take it seriously, Father God, that we may do your will, Lord. Lord, you send this man to us, Father God, not to joke around, not to play around, but to give a word to deliver us, Father God. Lord, we are sinners, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I just pray for his strength, Lord. I 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 pray for his strength. I pray for the saints, Lord. I pray that you give us strength, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, in your heavenly name, Father God. I just thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. May we thank you without ceasing, Father God. Lord, oh my God. It's been a long time, Father God. It's been a long time. I pray for strength, Father God. Endurance, Father God. Patience, Lord. Patience, Lord. Patience, Lord. Patience, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Lord, I just pray that everything that is said is your will, Lord. Everything that's said is your will, Father God, over our lives, Father God, over this ministry, Father God. Lord, I just thank you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray for understanding. I pray that we understand that this is a man of God and this is not a joke, Father God. I pray that we listen, Father God. We hear your word, Lord. We hear your word, Lord. We hear your word, Lord. We hear your word. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I just pray that you open our ears, Father God. You open our eyes to what's going on, Father God, because there's a lot going on, Lord. I pray that you open our eyes, Lord, that we may hear you also, Father God, that we may walk in your purpose, Lord, that we may not be disobedient, Father God, that we may walk in your word, Lord. Oh, God, Jesus. Thank you, 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 Jesus, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Lord. Thank you for the correction, Lord. Thank you for the correction, Lord. Thank you for the correction, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. That he may not be weak, Lord. That he may not be weak, Lord. That you may strengthen him in your word, Lord. That we may all come together as one, Lord, and uplift him, Lord, and keep him in our prayers, Lord, and strengthen him, Lord, because this is a fight. This is a battle. This is constant, Lord. This is not one day, not one year, not 10 years, not 20 years, Lord, but this is a lifetime, Father God. This is a lifetime, Father God. Oh, God, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, may your will be done. May your will be done. You are doing it, Father. You are doing it, Father. You are doing it. Oh, in Jesus' name, thank you for sending your son to die for our sins, Father God. Thank you for sending your son, Father God. And like you send your son, you send this man of God, Father God. Thank you, Jesus, for this. Thank you, Jesus, for your word, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Come on, let's give God some praise. Amen. I wanna thank everybody for their obedience. Amen.
Hallelujah.
And I want to say to all of us, let us continue to pray ye one for another.